Welcome to BBC What's New.
Life on a farm can be pretty tough. Your livelihood relies on the quality of your harvest. So, the last thing you want is insects destroying your farm.
Oh no. So, what if technology was the answer to stopping caterpillars and other bugs from munching their way through your crops? British researchers think satellites could be the answer.
That's right. The new system predicts when insects might arrive using temperature data and weather forecasts.
In just a moment, we'll explain how it all works. But first, why don't we learn a bit more about some of the invasive species which are threatening food security across the continent?
Invasive insect species are one of the biggest threats to farms across Africa, and the damage they cause costs billions of dollars. The biggest culprit is the fall armyworm, which was first spotted in Africa just 2 years ago, and has since eaten its way across the continent, leaving only a few parts of North Africa untouched. It's best known for chomping through maize, but it also eats more than 100 other plant species, including cotton, sorghum, and potato crops. It has such a huge appetite that when it does invade, it can destroy up to 3/4 of a farm's crop. Another hungry caterpillar, which is wreaking havoc across the continent, is a spotted stalk borer. It tunnels its way through the inside of the maize cob and is found in East, Central, and Southern Africa. For a bug that's only 1 millimeter long, the silverleaf whitefly causes a lot of trouble. This tiny pest feeds directly on plant sap and also transmits plant diseases like the cassava mosaic virus and cassava brown streak disease. It's found in many parts of East and Central Africa. The tuta absoluta moth, also known as the tomato leaf miner, feeds on the tomato fruit and burrows into stalks to reproduce. It caused tomato prices to surge back in 2016 after it ravaged hundreds of farms in Nigeria. And the situation got so bad, the moth was nicknamed Tomato Ebola.
Well, those are just a few of the bugs that are affecting farms right across Africa. But there are many ways that people are trying to fight this, with everything from pesticides to technology. Let's find out a bit more.
George Mwembe is a plant doctor. Today, he's making his fortnightly visit to the small town of Kimini in Kenya's Rift Valley province. He treats crops ravaged by pests. This farmer's maize has been infested by tiny caterpillars. With the help of an app, he identifies the species and recommends the right pesticide and other measures.
Due to the increased income in my farm, my kids now can go, they can go to better school because of the consistent income that I'm getting from the farm output. Also, livelihood in my farm home has improved because I can see I can meet the basic needs for my family.
A world away at a powerful supercomputer data center in Oxfordshire, the UK Space Agency is trying to make life for Walter and other subsistence farmers even better. The plan is to use satellite data to develop a system that's able to predict pest infestations a week or more in advance. This map shows the land temperature, one of the major factors that drive infestations. The system combines that with weather and other local data.
The Plant Doctor scheme has been incredibly successful. It's helped 18.3 million farmers all across the world. And on average, their incomes and yields have increased by 13%. And it's hoped that the new predictive system could do even better, boosting that figure to maybe up to 20%.
Farmers are completely dependent on crops, the predictability of having a good yield to survive, but also to send their kids to school. And so if we can reduce the impact of pests, if we can enable them to get better yields, which is what we're already seeing, it will mean that they can help move out of poverty.
Farmers such as Lillian Wanyama now get alerts when the insects are coming and can take precautions before they arrive. The money she and others like her save and the extra food they produce will make a big difference to them and their communities.
Let's have a look at some other stories making headlines this week. First up, more than 150 nations have signed a major agreement on managing migration, which is when people leave a country in the hope of a better life elsewhere.
Part of the plan involves giving migrants access to basic services, but some critics say it will increase the number of people trying to move.
But governments don't have to sign up, and some haven't, including the USA, Australia, and several countries in Europe.
After 50 years of planning, Senegal has opened a museum of black civilizations, paid for with $34 million of Chinese investment. The architecture of the large circular building there is inspired by traditional southern Senegalese homes.
Recently, Senegal asked France to return 10,000 pieces of art to their homeland, so it's hoped that the museum will display some of those artifacts. Next, millions of dollars worth of African pangolin scales have been destroyed in Malaysia in Southeast Asia as part of efforts to stop the vulnerable mammals from being hunted and sold.
It's thought about 3,000 pangolins would have been killed to make this amount of scales. Pangolin scales are sold to people who wrongly think they have magical properties.
And this is the cast of Hollywood smash hit Black Panther. They're backing a new university scholarship aimed at getting more black women into entertainment and have announced the first person to benefit from it.
Yes, the scholarship is worth $250,000 and the lucky student will study in Los Angeles. Actress Danai Gurira said, "We know that if we want to live in a world that looks more like Wakanda, the first step is you invest in women and girls."
Wakanda forever!
Hey, what's up everybody? My name is Sheyi Shey and you are watching BBC What's New.
He graduated from Lagos State University and wanted to work in a bank, but he got into music, and even though most of his family thought it was a bad idea, he hasn't looked back. Mick, the man who calls himself lyrically insane, here's Bass One. He studied banking and finance at university, but wanted to do music. However, it took him a while before he had a breakthrough, and this is the track that made Bass One famous.
It's original, and it's something they've not heard before. Just imagine you seeing someone calling himself a madman. You know, you'd be wondering, you'd be curious that, why is this guy calling himself a madman? Yeah, I'm just trying to tell you people that, lyrically, I'm insane.
Feel it. This African must flew, and I go pack my money with a Ghana must go.
So tell me about growing up back in Lagos.
Yeah, growing up, I grew up on the streets, Oshodi to be precise.
You better feel my SWAG.
So everything I see, everything I've been through, I try to channel it into my music so that people can understand where I'm from, where I am presently, and where I'm heading to. Haters wanna be me, the top is where you see me. When I started this music journey, everybody was against me. My grandma was against me. My mom was against me, all my sisters were against me, everybody was against me. Just only one of my uncles and one of my younger cousins that was a bit supportive. You know, even to write my bars, to write lines, you know, I have to go and hide to write my lyrics, you know. Man, I'm just happy I didn't stop, you know? Because assuming I stopped, wow, I wouldn't be here today.
You'd be a sad man. You know? Well, so now that they've seen your success, do they come back and say, oh, I'm so sorry, I hate your
Yeah, definitely. My mom is more supportive. Like, she's like, oh, you're a grown man now, so feel free to do whatever you want to do.
Bass One attracted criticism after he supported Kanye West's controversial comments on slavery. Kanye had said on a TV show that the enslavement of African Americans over centuries may have been a choice. He did try to clarify later in a tweet that he meant mental slavery.
I supported it because now we don't even have to bring their ships down. We are the ones that are going to them, you know, to work and earn a living. But if your country is good, you won't have to do all that. But I think it's just about perception.
Some of your music, you tackle social issues. What inspired you to write Better They Come?
When I did that record in Nigeria, we're having a lot of crisis. We're having the old Boko Haram, we're having the fuel scarcity, we're having a whole lot of stuff. So, you know, the country was not just going well economically. So that song is like a message of hope to the citizens that it can get better.
I know you use English, you use Yoruba, you use Pidgin as well.
Yeah.
Do you think it's
really important to maintain use of your local languages.
It's not about language, it's about vibe. And once people can connect to your vibe, they can connect to your music worldwide. I'm a Yoruba boy, you get, so I have to prove that and export that to the world.
Some stuff.
Oh yeah, that was fun meeting Base One. Coming up on BBC What's New, we meet the Kenyan girls using their passion for football to help the next generation.
Now, no one likes rubbish, do they? It ruins the environment and it looks plain nasty.
That's especially true for Miss Simi from Nigeria. She's 11 and says she's on a mission to save her city of Lagos from environmental waste. Let's meet her.
And I'm on a mission to save Lagos from environmental waste. I actually love to call myself Miss Environment. Most people don't actually know the magic words, which are reduce, reuse, and recycle. They are the three R's. Reduce means using less waste. Reuse means turning your old stuff into new through using your creative or innovative ideas. While recycle means turning your old stuff into new, but this time you're using a recycling machine. When Nigeria dispose of their refuse improperly, it makes me really, really angry. The waste I pick every day is caused by Nigerian people, and this is so, so annoying. Ugh. I love to educate kids right from their tender age. So when they grow up, they can be caretakers, they can be environmentally responsible and environmentally conscious at all times. Well, the reason why Nigeria should take care of the waste is because it reduces the level of waste in the dump site. Because in most dump sites, the level of waste are very high, it's even as high as a building.
Well done, Miss Simi. We love hearing all about the interesting things you do. So please do get in touch with us with your stories.
That's right. If you have anything you think we should feature on our show, just send us an email at whatsnew@bbc.co.uk.
It's time to talk about donkeys, because around the world, they're facing a population crisis.
That's right. There's a huge demand for their skins in China, where they're used to make traditional medicine. Donkey meat is also a popular food, and a big drop in the numbers of donkeys in Asia has forced suppliers to look elsewhere, including in Africa. And that's made the cost of buying a donkey much higher.
Christine has gone to Lamu on the northeast coast of Kenya to find out why their donkeys are so important and what they're doing to make sure that they're taken care of.
There are over 50 million donkeys around the world and have a reputation of being stubborn. But this is not the case when it comes to the donkeys in Lamu Island, located in the northern coast of Kenya, which boasts of a rich culture and history. The streets in Lamu are narrow, meaning traversing the island by car is impossible. Instead, there are over 10,000 donkeys used for transporting goods and people through the town. Well, we know once in a while animals get sick and go to a vet, but the donkeys in Lamu Island have their own special hospital where they get admitted and treated. Quite interesting. I met Dr. Felix, who is the famous donkey's doctor in Lamu.
We mostly get wounds because most of the donkeys here are working donkeys and they carry weights on their backs. So these weights, when there's inadequate padding, end up causing some wounds on their backs. So we get so many wounds. And we also get lameness, and this lameness as a result of overloading of this donkey.
The donkey doctors are all volunteers and operate on all the donkeys for free.
We want the entire community to now take up that responsibility and take care of their donkeys.
After a very informative chat with the doctor, I decided to talk to Fadil, one of the donkey owners in Lamu, to find out why these animals are so important to him.
All my life, it's donkey in Lamu.
It's donkey in Lamu.
Fadil has 11 donkeys that he rents out for day-to-day jobs and others that participate in the donkey races during the Lamu Cultural Festivals.
Donkey have a big importance in Lamu. For all the houses of Lamu, they breed by donkey. I'm always a big champion because I love my animals.
I was so excited and couldn't wait to ride Mwingereza, the champion of donkeys in Lamu.
Taxi of Lamu.
Thanks, Christine. Since animal charities warn that donkey populations are in danger, many countries have been taking steps to protect them.
That's right. Mali, Senegal, Botswana, Burkina Faso, Ethiopia, and Zimbabwe all have laws in place to protect donkeys, and Nigeria is trying to join them. In Nigeria, it's reported that between 2,500 and 4,000 donkeys are slaughtered every single day, which has meant that they're almost extinct in some areas.
There could soon be a new law in Nigeria which would ban people from killing donkeys and exporting their remains. Anybody who breaks the law could face up to 10 years in prison. Charities say there's still much more that needs to be done, but it's a step in the right direction.
Now, our next story is a pretty inspiring one. Kennedy Odede grew up in one of the poorest neighborhoods in Nairobi, where much of the water supply is dirty and controlled by gangs. So he was determined to do something about it and bring clean water to the area. Let's find out more.
Local mafias control the water supplies here, and their pipes are contaminated.
Look down there. Oh, look at that now. Look at that. Oh, my God.
Why can't we have a bigger pipe that passes on our roofs? There is no contamination. Ah, that's better than the water in my house.
Kibera in Nairobi is one of Kenya's poorest neighborhoods. Kennedy Odede lived here as a child.
This is the uniqueness of Kibera. Where in London or New York, you can just walk and start feeding chickens. So here is our house here. 8 people in this house is 10 by 10. And it was a tough life. I played here as a kid. So when I was here, we used to have a lot of problems with our stomach. There was not really clean water, to be honest with you. We have to walk for like something like 40 minutes. You know, there used to be water shortage too.
Kibera is an unofficial settlement and the infrastructure is poor. Mafia gangs siphon off nearby water supplies. Their pipes run through dirt and sewage. The gangs then sell the polluted water.
This comes from here direct. Look at it. Do you see this?
Yeah, there's stuff floating around
in
the water.
This water is a clean bottle. It's contaminated with sewage. This is what they're selling to people.
I'm shaking now. Look at that.
So Kenny's solution is to dig his own borehole and treat the water. Then pipe it around Kibera on top of these blue posts.
The idea of the aerial pipe water was not my idea. It was the idea of the community. Try up. Well, there's no sewage up, you know, and it's leaking, we can see.
He sells it at these kiosks and charges much less than the gangs.
Before, we used to get water, 20 litres, at 20 shillings or 10 shillings, but now we find that we can get water at 2 shillings.
It has helped me save economically and also has prevented me and my family from getting waterborne diseases.
Kenny's had to do deals with the mafia gangs.
They started cutting the pipes at first. It was really terrible. So what I did, so some of them, I took their wives or their children to be the ones selling water in our kiosk. So I also give them income. That's how we're able to survive.
Kenny now gets a good salary from his charity, Shopco. But he hasn't forgotten his roots.
Whoever wears the shoes knows where it pinches. We in the community, we wear these shoes of poverty, of struggle. We know where the pain comes from. So if we come together, we can solve it.
What an amazing story.
Mm-hmm. And there's even more good news. Kennedy has won the prestigious $2 million Hilton Prize for his invention.
That's the world's biggest humanitarian award. He says he's now going to help other countries set up similar water systems.
Love that. Now, lots of young boys grow up kicking a ball around in the street, and some go on to make a career out of the game that they love. But it's not always so easy for girls.
Well, we've been to meet one young Kenyan who's passionate about football and is using her skills to help the next generation of female footballers.
I'm Cherry Savilia Salano, my nickname Avish. This is Mbotela Kamaliza's ground, it's called Canon Apollo, where I started playing football in 2003. This is where my dream started. Football to me, I can say, it eases my worries. It's like therapy to me. My grandfather used to play football, so maybe it's in my genes. And I didn't like the gali-gali stuffs. I was like a tomboy back then. And I remember starting playing football, I started playing without soccer boots. Playing with boys, at first it was very tricky because boys being boys, they like teasing girls, but with time they got used to me playing with them and it was like I was just one of them. My parents, they didn't want me to play football. They wanted me to concentrate more on education. What made my parents to change, it's when I didn't have the school fees to join high school. And I met someone who paid my school fees. So after that, they were really supportive. There was a time we were playing a tournament in Makadara Estate. It was an under-14 tournament. I was the only girl. I was scared to play because I was so shy, I didn't want to play, but the coach encouraged me to play. I ended up the tournament being the top scorer amongst the boys. I cherished that moment. My first match in Kenyan colors, it was a qualifying match, AFCON qualifiers against Rwanda. For every player, you dream that one day I'll play for the national team. So when you get that opportunity to be there, you really feel like. My dream is to go pro, but we know it's not easy for us Kenya. So I see myself being a coach. We're giving back to the community.
Avish, role model wenu ama wetu wote.
Yeah, I'm really proud because he connects with the kids and it also helps us to show the kids they can reach where she is, has reached, even go further.
It melts my heart because I know my story inspires another person. They want to strive to be like me, even though I've not achieved much, but I know there's someone who is really, really wants to be like me.
Oh, inspiring. But that's all from us for now. Don't forget to check out our YouTube page where you can find more from the What's New team.
Oh yes, just go to youtube.com/BBC What's New. And don't forget to hit that subscribe button to keep up to date with all of our latest interviews and stories.
That's all for now, but we'll see you next week.
Bye.
Bye.